I've been doing a lot of server, you know, weird stuff, non-web stuff in my career. And I had recently to make a control system that talked to a few weird hardware like projectors and IP paste buffer bars and like weird things that don't have, you cannot download the client, at least not yet in Erlang or Elixir. So I had to read some TCP specifications and implement my own stuff. And in that process, I realized that there's not a lot of material out there if you want to do this kind of thing. And I thought, okay, perhaps I could condense a little bit of what I found and some pain points and some things that might trip you up, if you, especially if you don't have, if you haven't read the 600-page TCP/IP illustrated book. Because the official documentation is complete, I would say, but it's really all over the place and it's really hard to, you know, there's no quick start, you're just on your own. So before we actually go into code, I'd like to just spend 1 minute talking about the underlying protocol of TCP/IP. So IP, we know about IP, it's the IP address, all that. IP stands for Internet Protocol. And basically it works like we did in school, where you just write a small message on the piece of paper, fold it up, write a name, and hand it over to your classmate. And then you hope, you just hope that they will pass it on that the correct direction, right? And it's the same thing with IP packets, in that they are small, they might be 1 or 2 kilobytes, depending on, you know, a lot of things, and they just have an IP address on top, and then you hand it over to your router, and then the router hands it over to your ISP, and you just hope, and that's it. You really hope that it will get eventually there, and you have no way of knowing that it got there until the other side replies, and then you have no guarantee that the reply will actually even arrive at your destination, because some router might just drop it. So there are a lot of problems in this, and not, I shouldn't say problems, because it's the design of the system, and like, what happens if your data doesn't fit in one packet? Then you have to split it up, send 2 packets, and then there's no guarantee that the first packet will arrive first. So the remote side has to have some way of saying, okay, this is packet number 1 and this is packet number 2, and I'll just join them together. And when you actually, you know, go and read how all this works, you'll be amazed that everything still works and we can just, you know, read our mail every day. And really makes you appreciate all the engineering thought that has gone into it back from, you know, the 70s. So TCP over IP stands for Transport Control Protocol over Internet Protocol, something like that. And the whole idea is that you take these chaotic packets flying around with no guarantees, and you provide a stream abstraction over that. So the same way that the telephone works, in that you pick up the telephone, you dial a number, or, you know, used to dial a number, and once that connection happens, you can just speak. You don't care how things work. You speak into one side, you listen from the other side, and it's the same way with a TCP connection, in that you have something that is a stream, and you can read to it, you can write to it, and data arrives at the other end, and vice versa, you can read and write to the stream. So to actually use that in our day-to-day code, there is one prevailing API that was designed back in 1983, I think. It's called the Berkeley Sockets, and it was originated in the BSD Unix distribution, so the Berkeley distribution of Unix. And it turns, what it does is it makes that a TCP connection behave like a file. So once you use those weird functions to create a socket, you can then use your usual I/O functions to read and write from and to the socket, and it behaves kind of like a file. So you write bytes to that handle, and magically, sometime later, those bytes will arrive at the other end, and the other way around. And this is now a POSIX standard for a long time. It's most probably implemented by the operating systems we use every day. And the thing is, because it's real life code that not some, you know, abstraction, it breaks the illusion. So it's not like the telephone where you just speak continuously, because we are working with bytes, and bytes have sizes, and you have to fit them in memory somehow, somewhere. So there's a few already we start to see that why TCP/IP is a bit complicated to use daily. So GenTCP is actually an Erlang module. It's right in the distribution of Erlang. And it exposes the BSD socket API to the Beam. And it does that in a way that feels slightly more Beam native than what you would have with the plain C functions. And so the issue with GenTCP is that it's both intricate to use and configure, and when you read the documentation, you see a lot of arcane-looking options and all that. So this is actually the entire API for GenTCP. There's no other functions in there. But when you actually go to use it, you'll see that you have to also learn about the INET API, which only has, this is two functions that are the most common to use. There's like other 5 or 10 functions that are a bit peripheral. But that setopts function has a list of options that you can pass to it. And that list of options is huge. And it's like 40 different things that all come together. And then you can, of course, drop down to the row BSD API. And then you can start creating a binary struct that gets passed raw to the operating system. We won't see any of that today. But if you want to actually go and have a look at how this is documented, you should, because it gives a lot of options that you could use and you might find useful. So let's go and have a very quick look now at some code. And we will write a very simple server that accepts connection on port 4001. And when a client connects to it, it will just send the current date as a string and then close the connection. So let's see how that could work. And this is now blind. So we are this one. So, oops. I should have done it the other way around. So the server is running on one side, and I just connect to it through my client, and I could use the same way with Netcat. If you don't know, Netcat is a thing like cat, but over the network. So it will just print out to the thunder out everything that arrives to it. So you can use the same thing. You get that string, so you see that the date is current. And we can even use Telnet. And Telnet prints out a lot, some like noise there. But the last two lines are what the server returned. And then Telnet prints out that server closed the connection. So that's the demo. And let's go and have a look what the server looks like. So this is, you have to wrap a module around that to actually make it work. But those two functions are the server. And the first part is that you call GenTCP listen, and you pass it a port. And then that options we've been talking about. So options is a list. And it could be it has both atom pairs, like a tuple of keyword and value, or it has just plain atoms in there, and it's really convoluted. But most of the time, you'll use binary, which means treat the data that I'm giving you and the data that you're giving me as binaries, because the default is char lists, which is the Erlang strings, which is just list of integers. And in Elixir land, they're not as useful. Reuse adder is some arcane thing that's nice for the demos, because otherwise, we'd have to wait 1 minute or so until we could rebind to that port. Don't worry about it. So we call GenTCP listen, and we get back a listen socket. And we just pass it over to our server handler. And what that does is that it calls accept on that listen socket. So far, the listen call is just returns almost immediately, but the accept call here is actually blocking. So the code will stop here until a client connects. And when a client connects, now we have our socket, right? And this socket in Erlang is actually a port. Let's not get into that level of detail, but the socket is something that's stateful. So you can write to it, you can read from it, and all that. Once we have that, we calculate the time, and we convert into a string, and we call gentcp send with using the socket and our binary, and we just tack a new line at the end to make it a bit nicer for the demos, and then we call shutdown. And what that will do is that once send returns, it means that the data is no longer at our control, it's gone over to Erlang, and eventually Erlang will pass the data to the operating system, and eventually the operating system will actually send the data over to the destination. And shutdown just ensures that the packet, the TCP packet that actually signifies the closing of the connection, will get delivered after everything else. So usually, you don't usually have to close a TCP socket, because when your process that opened the socket dies, it will close it with it. But for the demos, we use shutdown, so we are just make sure that everything arrives. And then once that happens, we can just call accept again on the socket, and now we are ready to serve the next client. So the listen socket is long-lived, but the accept socket, the accepted socket, is represents one connection from the outside. I showed in the demo that we can also write a client for this kind of thing. So it looks really similar in the sense that it's two functions, and we'll see why in a bit. But what we do is we connect, we pass in the address we want to connect to, the port, the same list of options or a similar looking list of options, and we get a socket. And this is, again, blocking. So once we have the socket, it means that we are connected to the server and we can start doing things with it. The major problem here that you will probably run into is that you have to pass in the address as a char list. So notice single quotes around the host. If you pass in a string, you will get an error, bad arg. Figure it out. No, use that, use single quotes, and you can use IP addresses or other weird stuff in there. The documentation shows, you know, the types that you can pass in there. And we also see that we use binary again, because we want to stay in binary land and not use char lists for the data. But there's also active true, which is actually the default, but it's a good opportunity to talk about it. And we'll see why in a second. Now, we have the socket, and then we call this client function, client handler function, passing that socket, and we immediately go into a receive block. And the reason we do that is because the active mode means that Erlang will deviate from the BSD API, and it will convert the incoming data into Erlang messages. So there is two kinds, well, there's three or four kinds of messages you can receive. The basic ones are a three-element tuple that has a TCP atom, the socket that actually used, that actually sent the data, so you can handle many sockets in the same connection. In my case, I just matched on the socket that we used for, to be clear about that. And the last element is the data. And because we passed in binary, this is now a binary. When that happens, we just write out to the standard I/O, and we wait for the next message to arrive. So the client in this case has no idea what's coming. So it will just wait, many messages will arrive, and then eventually the socket will be closed, because from the other side we called shutdown. So eventually the socket will be closed, and then we will receive the TCP closed message, and then we just print out that it's closed, and we die. So everything clear so far? Yeah. So if you remember the server code, I'll just jump here a bit. The server code as it is right now, as it is shown on the screen, can only handle one client at a time. And why is that? Because we have a single Erlang process. We called accept, and accept this blocking. So while we are blocked there, no other clients can come in. So they will not get refused the connection because there's some pooling going on behind the scenes for the listen socket. Read the documentation about that. But they will not be connected until the first client exits. So of course, this is very common in many programming languages like Python, Ruby. You have to spawn multiple processes to handle this. But in Elixir world or the Beam world, it's just trivial to do to accept multiple clients at the same time. We just spawn processes. So what I've done here is instead of just calling the server handler directly as we did before, we spawn 10 processes running that function at the same time. So now we can accept 10 clients at a time, and we have to sleep the main process because otherwise our program will exit. Of course, you wouldn't do it this way. If you have to do it in production, you would use something like Ranch, which is the library that Phoenix and because it uses, sorry. Ranch is a TCP acceptor pooling library. So if you want to accept multiple clients, you do essentially this kind of thing. And if you're using Phoenix, Phoenix uses Cowboy and Cowboy uses Ranch. And if you ever went into your process diagram, you will see that there is a Ranch supervisor with 100 workers by default doing essentially this thing for you. So just like that, we've eliminated all the complexity that, for example, Python used to have. You'd either have to spawn new processes, like operating system processes, and then try to coordinate between them, or you would have to go the async way, where there is some other API that you can listen on multiple sockets and all that. It's complicated. This is way, way simpler. So the code we've seen so far is very simple, Hello World style. Let's go and have a look at some code that does a little bit of more complicated back and forth. And we'll have a server that accepts connections. And when the client connects, the server will send that greeting. And this is mostly like the, I think, SMTP works, where you connect and the server immediately sends hello. Then the client, when it receives that hello thing, it will sorry, let's talk about the server first. The server will send hello, and then we'll wait until the client sends some data back. And then the server will take the data and send it back using that hello name. And then the server will close the connection. The client, on the other hand, it will connect to the server, wait until it sees that hello binary, then send some data over, and then just read all the data and wait until the connection is closed. So we have a demo for this as well. And we have here. Sorry. This is our server. Whoops. Of course. So this is now okay, a bit easier. So the server now is waiting for connections, and I will launch the client. And something has happened because I'll just write my name here, Elixir. Whoops. Oh yeah, timeout. We'll talk a little bit about that later. Let's be a little bit faster. Okay, so the server is now doing that, and the client shows us how all this worked. This never happened when I did it at home. So the server, the listen part is the same. So I'm just showing the handler part, and you can spawn this in one process or how many processes you want. So we, again, call accept, waiting for a connection. And then the moment we are after accept, it means we have a connection. So we send that hello thing. And then the server goes into the receive block, so it blocks. And then when that message arrives, means the client has sent us something, so we then call send again and shut down the socket. The idea here is mostly to illustrate that we can have the server both read and write data, right? It's a two-way stream. There's no client or server. Once the connection happens, you don't know who started it. Either side can close, can read, can write, can do whatever. The client is also the same. Just here we pattern match a bit better because we are waiting a specific thing to arrive. So we can pattern match on that message and say, okay, when that happens, do this. In our case, we just know. Read from standard in and whatever, trim it, send it back. And the other cases are exactly the same. So this is the active mode where incoming data gets turned into messages and you use a receive block to handle them. The most traditional way, which is the BSD way, is to have a passive mode, which is a no Erlang magic going on. You have your file, and at some point in your program, you read some data from the file. And this, of course, means that if you want to read more data than is available, your code will block. You have to use a timeout. The most important thing here is that the way TCP was designed, it was designed to make sure that one side that is producing a lot of data will not overwhelm the other side that processes the data or reads the data. So TCP has built in a back pressure mechanism. So if one side is just not reading the data at the same rate as the other side is writing, TCP has a way to throttle the sending side. So it will send back messages saying stop or other. Anyway, it will do something, some magic, to ensure that your this doesn't happen. When you use active mode, though, Erlang will consume all the data as it becomes available. So you don't get to use that back pressure mechanism because the operating system doesn't know that your process hasn't processed the data yet. It knows that Erlang read the message from the buffer, read the data from the buffer, and it will just send you more. So instead of using the back pressure mechanism of TCP, you have to design your own back pressure mechanism. Otherwise, your process message inbox will flood, and you will kill your VM. So most of the time, we use passive mode. And of course, this is only relating to the receiving of data. Sending is the same because sending is this weird thing that is both blocking and non-blocking. But there's no Erlang magic for the send. So the server is really quite the same. Instead of using active is true, we use active is false. And instead of having a receive block, we call gentcp receive. And we have a 5,000 milliseconds timeout. And we say that we want to read 0 bytes. And we'll talk a little bit about that later. The client it gets a little bit bigger. So when you connect, you pass in active false. And when you actually want to read, instead of having a receive block, you again call receive, passing the number of bytes you want to read, which is 0, and we'll see. 5,000 is the timeout, and you'll get just either OK and your data, or error and some error, which in our case, it means that the socket is closed, and the demo is exactly the same. We won't do it again. So the major thing that passive mode introduces is the receive function, and it has two flavors, one without a timeout and the other with a timeout. And when you pass in length that is a number that's not 0, it means I want to read this number of bytes, 100 bytes, something like that. And your code will block until the operating system has received those 100 bytes. When it does, you know that you get 100 bytes back, no more, no less. When the length is 0, it means read, give me any bytes that you might have. And this is problematic, and we'll see in a bit why. So here is a naive, extremely naive HTTP client. It tries to download Mary Shelley's Frankenstein from Project Gutenberg. And it's essentially the same. You connect to that host at port 80, which is the default HTTP port. We use passive mode. And we send that the HTTP header, right? So this works, but I won't go into the demo because we're running a bit late. So if you send, this actually works, but the problem here is that the response that we get is 15,000 bytes, which is not enough to contain Mary Shelley's book. So why is that? Well, the problem is that you don't really know at this level of code, you have no idea how large the response of the other end will be, right? So in passive mode, this is very explicit because you have to pass in a number and it forces you to think about that number. In active mode, you have the opposite thing in that, or a similar thing, in that if you, we try to pattern match before at that hello string, right? And of course it worked because we are doing very little data back and forth and we're talking over the local host, so things pretty much work out. But in actual real world case, you might first receive 3 bytes of hello, so H-E-L, and then after, you know, a couple of milliseconds, you might receive the other part. So your pattern matching logic is now broken, because there's no guarantee, because it's a stream, right? A stream doesn't have a beginning and an end. It's just a stream of bytes, and you need to add your own level of handling on top of that. And we call this protocols, and the protocols just try to give a shape of on that stream. And some of them are common, like HTTP or memcached, and some of them are niche, like the ones I had to implement, and some of them are going to be your own when you want to design a TCP-based application, and some are even provided by GenTCP, but they're not as useful as I would hope. So a protocol specification, when you read it, essentially it's a distributed state machine. So it tells you, okay, which party goes first, which party goes next, what shape should the data have, who is responsible for this, who is responsible for that, and all that. And some of them can be really complicated, like the, really simple, like this is an RFC 867, which we implemented in 10 lines of code because it's trivial. It just says send back the day, the daytime as a string, and I don't even care what the string looks like. So that's easy. HTTP, on the other hand, HTTP 1.1 is 176 pages, and this is why you don't write your own HTTP client. Memcached is 1,200 lines of text, so I think you should be able to implement a reasonably complete client in a week or so, if you find a way to test it. And let's go and see a little bit better HTTP client. The code is exactly the same as before. We connect, we send that the first part of the HTTP request, which are just the GET, then some headers, and we just you end with two new lines. You can see, I don't know if it's visible, but the last one is RN. So that's the signal for HTTP to say this is the end of my request. And then instead of just calling receive once, we have another function that I'll show, and you might guess that the list is going to be an accumulator of bytes. So this one looks like this, and it essentially calls receive in a loop until the connection is closed, which is a valid HTTP way of knowing that the response has finished. So I don't know if I should walk over this. We just call receive. We don't care how many, we don't know how many data will arrive. So we'll just say, give me everything you have. And we stick that on a buffer. And as long as we read data, we stick it on a buffer. So we just use the functional way of having an accumulator and we tack it at the beginning of the list. And then eventually, I know, eventually we should get closed. I just pattern match another for simplicity. And we will just reverse the accumulator. And now we have an IO data list and we just convert that into a binary. And that's it. Oh, that is early. So GenTCP, if you go and have a look, has a few built-in protocols. You would hope that it would help you design applications, but the problem is that you cannot extend them. They're set in stone, they will never change. And if they're useful, they are. If they're not useful, don't think about it. Go and write your own thing. The main idea of those protocols is that, for example, this is the prefix header length. And what it will do is it any time you call send, it will say, OK, you've asked me to send 200 bytes. I will tack one or two or four bytes at the beginning of your transmission, saying, OK, now follows 100 bytes. And when you use it on the receiving side, it will say, OK, I will expect the first two, one or two or four bytes to be the length, and I will read exactly 100 bytes. And that's it, and it actually does it transparently. So if you have a case where you control both client and server, you can use that, and you don't have to write any other logic. The amount of data you send is the amount of data you receive, and you don't have to think about anything else, buffering, whatever. And the cool thing also is that if you use active mode, you will also have guarantees that exactly the correct amount of data will be passed to your message, so you can go back to using this nice pattern matching style. The default is packet to be zero, which means no packet at all. Of course, it could have a better name, but it doesn't. The other protocol that might be useful with a very big caveat is the line protocol, in that it will read data until it finds a new line, or actually any line, any character that you can specify, and then it will send you that data as a message. A lot of protocols use new lines. The problem is they use both carriage return and line feed, so CRLF, if you've seen that, /r/n, to signify what a line means, whereas this protocol only accepts a single character. So again, not so useful. The cool thing about GenTCP, though, if you get to use these kind of protocols, if they're useful to your application, is that the socket itself is mutable. So you can start off at line mode, like memcached does that. It expects the first that you will give it a line, saying, OK, I'm now doing a set operation. And then it expects some raw data. So you can start by sending a line, and then you can call a specific function saying, OK, stop waiting for lines. Now we're back to raw mode. So the next time you receive or get a message, you will get raw data back. The most common way you do things is the same way as the prefix header length does it, or HTTP does it with the content length header, if you've seen that around, in that if you have your logic, and in your logic you say, and now I'm going to send you 500 kilobytes. And then the receiving code knows, OK, this is now what I'm going to expect from the other side. I think we have time for a demo. And this is the client, so instead of now, we don't have a server. Instead, we run memcached, and I have a very, very simple implementation, or very non-compliant client. And I will run that. And the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to set a value. This is the reply that memcached sends. And then I will get a value. And this is, you see that the first thing, the raw response, is a line. And then after, and it says 20. So 0 is some flags that it's 0. And 20 is the number of bytes that will follow this line. So if you count, there should be exactly 20 bytes in the hello from Warsaw string. And the code for this looks like this. For the get, I don't think it's useful to go through it. The basic idea is that you connect, blah, blah, you specify that the packet is the line. And this actually works, although it shouldn't work, so don't do this, but it's just an example of how you would do this kind of thing. So receive a line, and we know now that response should be a line. So the memcached protocol will send you a line no matter what. When you're doing, sorry, before that we send a line, say get elixir-conf, where elixir-conf is the key that we wrote just before. So we have the response, and we use pattern matching. Perhaps it's easier to do it like this. We use pattern matching, and we expect that it will start with value elixir-conf. This is all the protocol of memcached. And then we do some mangling there, wrangling, to get the length. Once we have the length, we call inet, which we talked about in the beginning, set options packet is zero. So we're now no longer in line mode, we're in row mode. And then we know exactly how much data we need to read. So this is what it looks like. So this is pretty much it from me. There is a very big pain point, and I wish I had an announcement to make, I don't. When you write TCP-based applications, there is, and the first time you do it, your code tends to be like interleaved. You have gen TCP calls here, gen TCP calls there, your logic all in between. And in most other programming languages, like I come from a Python background and I use Twisted extensively, and Twisted has this idea of the abstracting out the transport. So that your transport could be a serial port, your transport could be TCP port, could be an SSH or TLS port, could be a tunnel of things, and you don't really care as long as the abstraction of the stream is maintained. I couldn't find any library that would do this for me in Erlang or Elixir, and if someone wants to do this kind of work, I think there's a very big, nice gap. And if you are going to do some TCP-based applications, think about how you would test them, because you either have to mock something out, it's messy. Better to think about it before, and you also have to think about how to handle timeouts, because there is a timeout for send, there's a timeout for connect, there's a timeout for receive, there's a timeout for everything, and it's really not a good thing to realize all this after you've written all your code and say, oh, what do I do now? And it's a hard problem, and it doesn't have a good solution at the moment. So that's it from me. You can find all the slides and all the code at GitHub. Try and read the book, read the documentation, and we have 7 minutes for questions, so.
Any questions? Hands up.
No? It's okay.
No one's got a question. Okay. Thank you.
A quick one. What can you say about Unix domain sockets? Is there a related story?
Yes. It's not INET, the module, deals with Unix domain sockets, but you don't use gen TCP for that. You use something else, which I'm not really familiar. There's also, on that topic, there's gen UDP, which is UDP-based communication. It's a different model, but UDP doesn't have the stream abstraction, so it's a completely unrelated thing. But in theory, you could have the same code working with a TCP socket and with a Unix domain socket, because it's just a file to you, right? So you just read and write. But I haven't done that yet, but I know that it's possible somehow.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you. Thank you.